Good morning. How's it going?
Good morning. It's wicked. End of the week already. I can't believe it.
You know, I can't remember. Did we explain why we chose, if we've even formally chosen, the Business of Machining as the name of this podcast?
No, I don't think we have explained it. So
are
go
we
ahead.
Are we keeping that? I like that name.
I like that name a lot. Yeah, I like it. Let's do it.
Great. That's funny because there's like little subtle backgrounds of the complications of a quote-unquote partnership that are lingering in my head, which is funny because that's something I'm passionate about as well. And that's kind of exactly why we call this the Business of Machining. If you guys are listening and you don't know, John and I are both self-taught machinists, and we both run, you know, machine shops. John's more product-based. I'm kind of more all over the place. But we care not only about metalworking and machining, but also how do we make this work as relatively young guys that are trying to put food on the table running CNC machines. So I care about the business of it when it comes to operating our own businesses, but also partnerships and vendors and insurance and employees and growth and all that fun stuff. Is that fair?
Absolutely. Yeah. Just the entrepreneur side of it. I mean, we're both super nerds when it comes to machining, and due to that, we're trying to run big businesses, and we have to learn to be excellent entrepreneurs to be successful. Like, they go hand in hand.
It's funny because so many people that when I meet them or talk to them, talk about, they use the G word with me, which is growth. And I think when I try to take a step back and I look at the shop and the new machines, I guess I see that, but I'm curious, John, you know, I feel very much like every day is just the same, and in a good way, but you know, you get so caught up sometimes as a doer of things on a daily task basis that you don't see this. And I guess externally, look at you, John, you've now got a Mori, you've got this Nakamura, you've got systems in place, right? If somebody said that you've got crazy growth, do you smile and agree, or do you think, no, we've still got a lot more to go?
Growth, I would agree with, because, you know, I think of you back to your New York City apartment days when your tag was next to your pillow. You've grown, my friend. 5,000 square foot shop now.
Yeah.
Yeah, we've both grown for sure. We're not done growing. But the other side of that coin is, you know, the word successful. And if somebody looks at me and says that I'm successful, I don't necessarily feel like it because I have so far I want to go still. And I kind of realized lately that success is not a destination, really. It's like a lifelong journey. It's like you will never be the definition of successful. And if so, there's no point continuing. Like,
but you are successful in some people's eyes.
Of course.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, like I get the catch-22 involved, but like from my personal perspective,
right,
just keep growing, keep growing, keep going.
But you know, I was making a list last night of some of the best lessons I've learned in life. I thought it would be a great chip break video for us. And just the best advice I've received. And one of the things I've really been focusing on lately, and it'll come back a little bit to if we end up talking about my car accident last week, but you make your own happiness. Happiness is just like success. It's all relative. You can be happy or you can choose not to be happy. But I think as a type A kind of entrepreneur, driven person, I'm looking to prove myself, to keep doing more, to keep doing better. And what I hope is a healthy way. But I think sometimes for me, it's easy to let that kind of drag you down and not meet your own expectations. As an entrepreneur, nobody's there to give you a report card or a kudos or pat on the back. You know, you are leading the ship.
Yep.
And that's tough.
Absolutely. Yeah. I've heard the quote, Gary Vaynerchuk says, being an entrepreneur is getting punched in the face every day of your life forever. And you just,
that seems a little harsh.
You just have to smile and like it, you know, whether you get bad comments or emails or dissatisfied customers or, you know, you lose money, break anvils. Like there's always something. It's not sunshine and rainbows.
But that's why you got to love what you do.
Exactly.
You just have to, you know, you can't put out videos or you can't put out hundreds or thousands of a product. Or you can't spend hours tweaking cam unless you truly love it.
Yeah, and I think both of us are in a fantastic position where, man, do we ever love what we do? Like,
right. But be honest. Like, that's something else I'd say. Be honest with yourself. If you fall out of love with it, don't feel like you've got to put on a facade for yourself or your wife or your family or your friends to keep it up because you're worried. People change. Things change, you know? We've all been bounced around through different hobbies. Like, you and I both used to be super into computers, and we still do use computers, but they're not, you know, obviously the machining is where I think we've both been lucky enough to find our true passion.
Yeah.
How was your week?
My week was very productive.
That's great.
Yeah. I've been trying out a new experimental technology. I forget if I told you about it a couple weeks ago, but for doing our Rask blades, we've been milling the blade bevels with an end mill and getting not the best surface finish I would want.
This is with the fixture with the smooth on?
Yes.
Okay. I thought you were happy with that finish.
It's okay, but Eric is still sanding them out and making them pretty, and it's taking him forever. So I've been trying... I mounted a small grinding wheel to the spindle of the Mori.
Oh, you did?
I did. And
you told me, you had ordered it, so it came in.
Yeah, it came in. I've been working on it for several weeks now, on and off.
Oh my God.
And burning every single blade that I put on there.
Burn? Oh, too much heat?
Yeah. So lots of experimenting, lots of phone calls with people, had some tool and die guys come by trying to answer it. My salesman has been kind of useless. It's been a headache, but the few like odd times I get a halfway good result, the finish is amazing, except there's like four large burn spots here and there.
I assume you're just loading up the wheel?
Yeah, there's a lot going on. But you know Alfred at AB Tool?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I called him, coincidentally, like, right after he got spinal decompression surgery.
Yeah, I was just going to say, I think he's in the hospital right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I think I must have sent him a message on Instagram, like, within hours of when he was going into surgery, and I didn't realize at the time.
Oh my gosh, that's funny.
Yeah, so...
I think he's okay, which is great.
He's totally fine, yeah. Like, he's just recovering for the next few weeks, but he's good spirits and all that. Anyway, he put me in touch with this lady, Linda, who knows everything about everything surface grinding. She's the expert. She teaches classes. She's a genius.
Awesome.
And I talked with her for a long time, and she said, well, first of all, you ordered the wrong wheel, because my salesman told me to.
Yeah.
But we can make it work. So she gave me suggestions, and...
Wow.
We're getting really, really close.
So if you guys don't know, the fellow that John's talking about is Alfred at AB Tool. We did a video tour of their facility, and they use these diamond wheels in VMCs to grind a lot of the carbide, the custom ground solid carbide and inserts that they make, which is mind-blowingly awesome.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they have dedicated grinding machines too, but I mean, the fact that they can use a Haas from 1999 to grind,
right,
like with five-axis table, to grind quality inserts and tooling is amazing.
Right. And I suppose I just broke our rule, which is, isn't this supposed to just be me talking to you and not acknowledge the fact that this has turned into a podcast?
And we're going to have to jump back and forth.
So, sorry. No, but I want these, you know, if you guys are hopping into this podcast, you know, John and I talk every Friday morning. It's I think John called it a form of therapy, and it's totally true. It's a chance for us to share the highs and the lows of what we're stressed about. And being an entrepreneur is tough. You need that team of people, whether it's the team of people like Alfred that helps you out the tour, or whether it's a friend who's going through similar struggles. It ain't all peaches and cream.
Mm-hmm. And it's almost funny when we finally break down and tell each other something that's going on. The other person's always like, oh yeah, I've been there.
Yeah, right.
And it's like you're afraid to share it the whole time, but then it's this camaraderie of like, oh, I'm not alone. That's not a unique problem.
Everyone's been there. Everyone's been stressed about time, been stressed about money, been stressed about getting things to work. Okay, so sorry, I'll stop rambling. How is your... So did her advice get better results?
Hugely better results. One of the biggest things was I'm using a CBN grinding wheel, cubic boron nitride, and my guy, my salesman, said if you had a different kind of wheel, you would need a dressing stick. It's like this aluminum oxide stick that you literally shove into a spinning wheel to clean it out. But he's like, with this wheel, you won't need it. And then she said, it won't work unless you do this.
Yeah, I've never once heard of a wheel that didn't either need dressed, or like with the diamond stuff, you have to re-impregnate it's like a lap. You have to recharge the media.
Well, with this kind of thing, there's two different things. There's truing, which is with the diamond thing where you make it concentric. And then there's dressing, which is cleaning all the crap out of the wheel.
And right, re-exposing fresh.
Right.
Right.
And they're two totally different things. Like I have a diamond, you know, a diamond dressing point that I true the wheel with, but then she said, no, you have to have this aluminum oxide stick. So she's like, do you have any surface grinder wheels? And I'm like, maybe we do. You want a white one? So I found in my box of Tormach surface grinder stuff, I'm like, okay, yeah, I found this surface grinder wheel. Like she goes, okay, spin your CBN wheel at 3000 RPM and shove this thing into it. Really? Just with my hands. I'm terrified. Yeah. Right. You'll be fine. So I'm literally taking this like 6-inch grinding wheel and just rubbing it up against the spinning wheel in the Mori.
Oh my God. Yeah.
And I'll need a coolant filter, by the way.
Yes.
And then that opened up all the pores. It felt different. It looks different. It cuts different too.
So I am as green as they come when it comes to grinding, but I'm learning and talking, and I talked about this when I bought the Mora Okamoto a few weeks ago, and I talked about it last week at the scraping class because we were doing a lot of wheel dressing and tool grinding. And for surface grinders, a diamond insert will do both. It will shape the wheel or true it up, and it will re-expose fresh material to do. You don't need the aluminum oxide stick on a, but
that's on a surface grinder, like an aluminum oxide wheel, right?
I don't want to say what I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Because I believe a CBN wheel or a diamond impregnated wheel is different.
That I agree with. Certainly, I know diamonds are. So we used diamond wheels at the scraping class this past week. Really cool. They were turning at like 300 RPMs, 5 or 6 inch diameter wheels. And it was like so tranquil. Because it's such a slow RPM, and it gave you so much control over really honing or just dressing the ends of these scraping tools that were carbide.
Cool.
And you have to use diamond, I guess, or CBN to grind carbide. There's nothing else that's hard enough.
Right.
And these wheels are just laps, so it's just an aluminum disc. The aluminum being intentionally soft, and you buy diamond powder, and there's a process where you use something harder, like a ball bearing, to push the diamond lap material into the face of the aluminum wheel, and then that becomes your diamond, your lap, or your disc, and then you sharpen so many stones or so many blades with it, and then you feel the wheel, basically it feels like it gets smoother because the material and debris fills up between the diamond, and so the only way to fix it is to just add more diamond.
Fascinating. Yeah. Well, you brought it up. Talk more about the scraping class.
Yeah, so I was so excited. We're going to do a YouTube video, a couple on it, because it's something that's a little bit difficult to summarize in a brief manner as well as without the benefit of video. But scraping is using a hand tool, like a kind of looks like a chisel, to achieve incredibly flat surfaces, potentially even flatter than surface grinding. And this was one of my big questions. How is that possible? And it's possible because surface grinder is a machine. And that machine has wear and slop, and the bed will deflect as it's at different ends of the travel, of how the saddle supports the table travel in X and in Y. And the benefit of scraping, although it's a lot slower or more cumbersome or more difficult to do, is that you use a master, like a surface plate, that you can lap in so many cool things. I was nerding that the whole week because we were talking about this book from Wade Moore, I think, who built these jig boring machines that are like some of the most accurate machines made on Earth, and the foundations of mechanical accuracy, and how if you take three individual plates, regardless of their topology, you can get them dead flat. So you can create a master that's dead flat, and then you use a transfer process, like with bluing compound or fluid, to basically mark your high spots, and then you scrape away. At its essence, it's incredibly simple. You just scrape until you get something perfectly flat. There's additional benefits or reasons to scrape in terms of having points per inch. So instead of having a perfectly dead flat glass smooth, you actually want some topology. So I know that sounds like a contradiction because I'm telling you it's flat, but then I'm telling you that there's peaks and valleys. But the point is it's flat across the median or the top level of the whole part. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So those cavities do a couple things. They allow for oil pockets, some amount of oil, and they allow for avoiding stiction. Because if you have two perfectly flat things, they'll ring together,
right,
like we've ever done that with surface blocks. So you actually want that. And you can also then do what's called flaking, which I originally thought was what scraping was. Flaking is a much deeper gouge that actually does serve as not only a pocket for oil to live in, but a channel for oil to slowly move through a way or a give, etc.
Wow. Is it a lot more in-depth and complicated than you expected going in? Or
Richard King, who's like the godfather of scraping, at least that is alive and teaches these classes, it's a little bit of a, I don't want to say a dying art, but it's certainly, you know, linear ways are the thing that makes scraping potentially opposite something. But he's amazing, and his sort of motto is, teaching somebody to scrape something flat, it's easy. It's knowing where to scrape, how much to scrape, and then, you know, what's easy, what's harder, like I did a parallel. So it's one thing to get one side flat, then you have to get the other side flat and parallel to the first side or a 90 degree angle. The other cool thing about scraping that never occurred to me was, let's say you've got a 14 foot dovetail in a big surface grinder, or even heck, a 30 inch. Well, not everybody has access to a surface grinder. You can't always move that machine and tear it apart and get it onto a surface grinder table. So scraping With a $100 hand tool, you can do it in place. Sure, it takes longer, but I want to talk more about this in the YouTube video about just how different and when it's appropriate to scrape.
Wow, that's fantastic. Do you have an applicable purpose for it in your future?
Good question.
Or are you just amassing knowledge for fun?
Well, I definitely wanted to learn. It seemed like one of those opportunities to learn from somebody who it was the right guy to learn from. And a great group of people to hang out with. And I really wanted to go to understand why. And we nerded out. We talked about surface plates. We talked about indicators. We talked about tolerances. We talked about machine repair. We talked about, too funny, Richard King was visiting a company the week before our class, and he starts talking about it. He's like, yeah, it's a small machinery manufacturer. They're in Wisconsin. Their name is Tormach. And I'm like, no way. So he was actually at Tormach helping teach them some things about their machines, and including much better ways to tram and adjust dovetail gibbed machines, which is what a Tormach is. So I learned a lot about how to properly set a gib and how to properly measure backlash. Totally different than I thought before.
Wow. Nice.
So am I going to become a full-time scraper? No. But I'll tell you, it was really cool. I took my stare at precision level and put it on a granite plate and was able to see how it was out. And scraping something like that is actually pretty quick, pretty easy. So I do actually think I'll use it.
Fantastic. And I'm sure that your videos, once they go up, will provide a lot of value, sharing this knowledge.
Yeah, super excited. So the you would have loved it, John, because it was all about when two or three days into the class, a thousandth of an inch was a mile. there wasn't a single thousandth indicator in the shop. It was all tenths or maybe a half thou, which is what's so cool.
Yeah, love it.
Yeah. So what's on tap for today? What is the goal?
Today, I am going to be making a lot more rasc parts.
Okay.
I think I'm going to play with that grinder again. The grinding wheel. Last time I tried it after talking to Linda, I got the tiniest bit of burn. And I'm not sure exactly at what stage in the grinding process, because I'm doing a bunch of passes. Mm-hmm. So I just need to basically pause between each pass and figure it out. Yeah, and then I'll be playing on the Nakamura.
Sweet.
Making stop pins out of 17-4 stainless.
Yeah, I love that stuff.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Just production, basically.
That's great. Rasks are coming along, though.
Yeah.
I guess other than the blade and cup pump.
Yeah, that's the big thing, because they take Eric a considerable amount of time to finish. And if I can give him a better surface finish, then I reduce like 75% of his time on that part. So
what are you doing though? Do you have enough blades done the old way that take Eric longer so that you can play with the grinding? Or are you hoping that the grinding works?
We're in a, let's call it a lean system right now. So he was a little bit ahead until early mid this week when he ran out. And then I had to make a few the old way.
Mm-hmm.
So I think I made him six one day because he likes to heat treat six at a time. So yeah, so I made him six and then he did it the old way. And then even still, he figured out a faster way to grind them. He just tried something different. He's like, holy cow, this is way better. I can't believe I didn't try this.
It's funny because you talk about lean and six at a time. And one of the things I really took away from the scraping class was something I've kind of known consciously and subconsciously, but it's hard for me to acknowledge, which is slow is fast. Just slow your roll, Saunders. Don't move so fast, don't think so fast. And with scraping, you have to act like a detective. You have to assume everything is wrong, or you have to make no assumptions about what's right. And that mindset is something I really think will make me a better machinist and owner of a machine products company. Just like you're doing with a grinding wheel, is it run out? Is it wear? Is it rubbing? Is it coolant? You there's so many variables to think through and not get overwhelmed and deal with those.
Yeah, and we got to be detectives, and it's probably one of my most favorite parts of the job is R&D is figuring out how to do it. Once I have the method perfect, I almost want to hand it off to somebody else because I want to go on to the next challenge, but I don't have that somebody else yet, so.
Yeah, you'll get there.
Yeah.
But it is so fun. To be good at that is awesome. To problem solve. I love it.
So what's on tap for you today?
I've got a guy coming. I'm going to film a chip break after we hang up. And then I've got a guy coming at 10 to look at Tormach machines, driving a couple hours away. We have that every month or two, probably. Somebody wants to swing by.
Nice.
And then I have got to work on, I'm really close to nailing down our new product. But before I send out a batch to anodize, I want to just make a couple more and These are Tormach surface plates or Tormach fixture plates.
Right.
But super happy with the precision and everything there. Helping Jared with some talon job troubleshooting on a job shop run. You know, I told you we've been trying to kind of slow down the job shop work, but also keep it going with existing customers, because it's an important part of our business, but I want to focus on products. And so that's good. That's actually going well. And the paperwork for Noah just is coming through, which is going to let him spend the rest of his senior year of high school for the last 5 or 6 months. Instead of going to his lab for machining, he'll actually come here as a work co-op. So he'll be able to work a lot more.
Nice.
Really good.
Yes.
Really excited for that. I have a call with ClearPath Motors to troubleshoot a project we're doing with them, which is one of them is public. It's the 440 automation machine.
Yeah, the disc thing that loads parts.
Yeah, so that's all set up and ready to go. The other one I am not sharing yet because it is, if we pull this off, it'd be the coolest thing I've ever made.
Nice.
It was the mystery part from last week's Wednesday widget.
Yeah, I saw that picture.
Mm-hmm. So excited.
Well, I can't wait to see what you do with it.
Awesome. Let's see what else. I don't know. It was, I actually wanted to mention too, I am trying to take a little bit of time off this weekend, which actually isn't like me. I tend to work too much, and I know you know this, but I was in a pretty bad car accident a week ago, and amazingly walked away. A guy hit my car, merged into my lane. I was going 60. He was stopped, merged into my lane, flipped my car. I walked away from it, just banged up a little. But kind of makes you, I certainly feel invincible, not in an arrogant sense, but I don't ever reasonably contemplate leaving my wife and kids behind, let alone my business. And I've been struggling with, how do I think about it? Do I think about that as, hey, I really almost died, life is short, blah, blah, blah? Or do I think, hey, be grateful and appreciative, but don't let yourself get paralyzed, figuratively paralyzed by something that luckily wasn't worse. You know what I mean? Sort of a business as normal.
Right.
I certainly gave my wife a really big hug, and I want to spend some time with my kids this weekend.
Yeah, I'd say if anything, just appreciate life more.
Right.
You know,
right.
Be wherever you are. You know, if you're with your kids, be with your kids.
Right.
You know, cherish and make every moment as important as possible.
Yeah, super, super lucky, super grateful. It's a testament to modern vehicle safety standards and side impact airbags are no doubt what saved my life.
Wow.
So yeah.
Yeah.
I guess if there's one thing I'll say to people, the two takeaways, as silly as they may sound, were actually three takeaways. One, try, I know this is a little bit weird, but try not to have stuff loose in your car, because that could have killed me. I had a big, heavy object in my car.
Did you have that surface plate thing?
No. I had to ship them.
Okay, I was wondering, because I'm like, that's probably in his trunk, and he got in a car crash.
Even if it were in the trunk, it was in a Kia rental, so there was a hatchback thing, so the stuff in the trunk actually came into the back seat.
Really?
But the tire iron from the trunk, it detached and came into the back seat.
Oh my goodness.
My laptop, my suitcase all got thrown around. Heck, even a laptop can really hurt you or kill you.
Right.
Hit you hard enough. So try to keep stuff secure. I know that's a little bit of a difficult request, because I have a wife and family and kids. I'm not going to secure the car each time we drive down the road. Number two, carry tourniquets. The tourniquet was not used in this accident, but that if I had been cut badly, it took 8 minutes for the cops to get there. Just keep carry tourniquets, please. And then number three, a battery pack for your iPhone. I spent the next 2 hours on the phone with 911, with the cops, with Hertz rental car, with my wife, with my insurance agent. And I, most of all, just wanted to talk to my wife when I was done with all that stuff, waiting for the cops to go through the paperwork, and having a battery pack. And, you know, it's the end of the day. I had been traveling all day, so my phone was almost dead. And I'm really glad that I had the charger with me.
Yeah. Wow. Good advice.
Yeah.
I love it.
Awesome. Well, have a good Friday. Crush it, bud.
I will. You too.
All right. Take care. See you.
Okay. Take care. Bye.
Bye.